Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Payal Kapoor, and I'm going to take you a journey through life of the trodden path. Before I begin, I would like you to look at this video to get you going on this journey with me.
Come on, guys, get back to the baseline! Stoop slow!
Vamos! Fala, Marcelo! Vamos, rapaz!
Go! Get him move on now!
Come on! You look like a poodle, not a Rottweiler!
Venga, que pasa, que no me va!
Vamos! Sai dessa posição! Vamos!
Fuck! Stop!
Not good enough.
Your buddy should be on that line.
Hello, can you hear me?
Push it out, you lazy dick!
Venga,
you're strong! You're fast! You're beautiful!
Nothing can stop you! You're made of metal!
Do it again.
10 more reps. Let's go.
Vale, 10 more. Vamos, bravo.
Venga, ne.
Venga.
Tires, get back in the pool.
That, my friends, is the resilience of the human spirit. Beyond anything you, I, or anyone can ever imagine. You've heard the famous John Lennon quote, life is what happens to you when you're busy making other plans. That is what more or less sums up my life. As a young graduate from the Hotel Management Institute, I was looking at life ahead with lots of wonderful things, wonderful dreams, but well, life was waiting for me just around the corner with its own plan. It took me into a dark alley, very dark, very quiet, because due to a cerebral attack, I was rendered not just totally blind, but totally deaf as well. I was totally blind, totally deaf, and had lost my other senses, my sense of touch, taste, smell, along with that. What was that all about? Was that devastation? I don't think there was even a word to describe what that was like. I must take you back to a small story. While I was still a student at the Institute of Hotel Management here in Hyderabad, we had shared our campus with what is called the Vocational Rehabilitation Center of the government for persons with disabilities. So what they basically did was they taught people various skills. There were people with all kinds of disabilities that were made job ready, in a manner of speaking. And we as these young, cocky graduates, undergrads, sitting, you know, think we're very cool and fabulous, sitting around there watching people go by. I used to constantly see these bunch of people with different kinds of disabilities move around over there so effortlessly. Walk right around us, ahead of us. There'd be a group of blind people being led by one person. There'd be persons with hearing and speech impairment who were excitedly signing away, having conversations. A person with a wheelchair being pushed by someone who's probably more capable of walking. What was my reaction at that point in time? I looked at them and said, wow, how are they even living their lives? They don't look unhappy. They don't look sad. They don't look depressed. They look like just you and I are. We're sitting here, bound to classes, grumbling about things we don't want to do, and just look at these people. Did I know? In less than 2 years, I would be blind myself. No, I didn't. But as life would have it, I was. Was I thinking of them at that point in time? Definitely not. Did I at that point in time think that, wow, those people looked so happy? Of course not. Why would I even do that? I was too busy being miserable and feeling sorry for myself and saying, God, what is this? How can you even do something like this? But that took some time and some doing. I'm not going to dwell on that. That's a thing way back in the past. What I'm going to talk about and dwell upon is how behind every adversity is an opportunity. Behind every human being that suffers, there is a solution. There is creation. There is things that you can do which you absolutely thought was not possible. How can you do that? I first started after 6 years of sitting around the house and doing little things and getting used to being disabled. I had one hearing in 1 year back, so that was a saving grace. What were the fears I faced? I was facing fears like, how am I going to walk? I can't see. Shut your eyes and try to walk, any of you? Can you? No. Your first thing, I'm not saying you can't, you can. But the first instinct is no. Did I want to climb on a bike that I had ridden with a friend for years on end? No. How was I going to get on a bike? I can't see it. Did I want to eat my own food in a restaurant? Definitely not. My noodles would land up in someone else's plate and my fork would go into my nose instead of my mouth. Did I want to do any of that? I didn't want to do any of that. But then, as I started looking at the possibilities, I realized that my sense of touch was so much stronger and that I could do so many more things by not seeing and simply touching. As I got used to my blindness and whatever relative darkness I was living in, I have to tell you, I became the most competent person around my house when there were power outages. Everyone's flailing about saying, where's the candle? Where's the torch? I'm like, hang on, sit there. I'll go find it for you. Efficiency. I discovered it. I observed my strength. And I created an opportunity. I was educated, but illiterate, because I couldn't read, I couldn't see. What did I do? I learned Braille. Cried about it. Buckets of tears. My teacher called me drama queen. I said, you can call me what you want. I cried. Every time I cried, he laughed. I was like, this is not funny. Did I learn it? You bet I did. What did I do next? I became a teacher. What was I doing? Teaching Braille to other blind people. I had created an opportunity and I had grabbed it. I was looking at how I would move around. What would I do independently? Did I want to lift the cane? No, I didn't want to lift the cane. My vanity would be affected. I'm all dressed up and holding a white cane and moving around like a blind person. I didn't want the world to recognize me as a blind person. That sense of acceptance and denial is something that all of us go through in various stages of our lives. You all are facing exams. You are looking at what you need to do. Do you want to do this? You're looking at the toughest subject or the toughest topic, and you're saying, no, I don't want to see this just now. Maybe I'll do it later. So you'll mark it in the book and you'll put it off for later. What are you doing? You're denying it. Do you have an option but to do it at some point in time? No, you don't. You have to do it. So what do? At some point in time, you look at it, you pick it out, you read it, and then you say, hey, what was I grumbling about? It's so simple, yeah. That's what I did. With most things in my life, I learned to read, I learned to write, I taught, I learned to walk, I learned to move around with friends, with family, and much later on my own. I looked at everything as something new. I created solutions for myself. Then came the big challenge of technology. A lot of you are aware, I remember hearing somebody talking of apps, games for the visually impaired. So there are those kind of things available. But to somebody who was, you know, not particularly interested in technology, there I was looking at, you know, a screen reading computer, something that I'm not looking at. First and foremost, I'm looking at that huge big keyboard without even looking. And then I'm listening to something that I don't know. It took me a long time before I could actually adapt to using a PC with a screen reader. Today, I have to very proudly tell you, I take down every single update of Windows 10 that comes. I do all my updating and my installation of apps myself on my phone as well as my PC, and I run with it. Such a sense of accomplishment, I cannot tell you. For somebody who cries over everything new, I think it's a fabulous sense of accomplishment and achievement for myself. And I pat myself on the back every time and tell 5 other people, look, this is what I did, you have to be proud of me. We all need that sense of assurance. We all need that sense of being able to do things. I realized the strength of my hands and the strength of my power of touch. And I realized my love for cooking had gone away, and yet I could manage things. There was so much that you don't see that you can actually do. You must try it. You shut your eyes and you do various things around the house. You realize that you do it far better than you would when you're looking at it. Now people say, I can't find this in my cupboard. They're looking at it and scurrying and touching and, you know, messing up the whole arrangement of the cupboard. I tell them, what do you want? I'm looking for something, something. Dig my hands in, shuffle around things, and pull it out. My sense of touch is that much better. Maybe if you closed your eyes and tried to do something without actually looking at it too hard, you wouldn't feel so boggle-eyed and be able to actually do something. It is very true. It happens. So I became a cook. I became a baker. I enjoyed my time, downtime, with sitting and baking. The smells of things, I was able to identify things by touch. You have special equipment marked with braille, things like cups and spoons, etc., that are available. You have things like weighing scales that are available. A lot of speech-enabled things that are enabled today. It is all available. It is for you to decide you want a solution and to pick it and use it. Out of my letters to friends, that used to be funny. And they always told me, hey, you write funnily. I always said, okay, it's boring. I don't want to write. I suddenly realized that I had a talent for writing. And my experiences as a blind person were actually going to be useful for someone else. So what did I do? 3 years ago, I made myself a blog. I started chronicling experiences, my experiences with disability, and talking about issues that were important, that were not just mine, but many other people like myself, and metaphorically speaking, of others in this world. What happened? I became the voice for so many other people. And so many people came back and said, you know, we feel exactly the same way, but we couldn't put it in words. I became a writer. I thought I wanted to travel on my own, but then I was very frightened. I said, no, I can't do this here. I mean, imagine going there and you'd get lost and somebody. I said, no. Then one day I told myself, no, I have to travel. How long can I keep depending on people for something or the other? It's very frustrating when you're depending on people and they're not available for you when you want them. I decided that I wanted to travel, and I wanted to travel to a different place. My family was completely stunned and they freaked out on me. They said, no, no, how can you travel alone? What is traveling alone? You're traveling in an aircraft full of people. How is that even alone? And we get fabulous assistance. Thanks to a whole lot of laws and things that have come in, we were able to travel on our own very comfortably. In fact, I think everybody else must be jealous of me because I walk in like a queen. I have somebody helping me. I have someone rolling my trolley. I have somebody taking my identity card and going there and checking me in. I cut through every security queue and I'm right in the front and I'm sitting pretty. That's just me. What can I say? I traveled. The exhilaration of getting out at the airport and walking in was so freeing, I cannot begin to tell you. These experiences are mine that have changed me, that have made me a new person, that have made me a person I never thought even existed within me. What does it do for you as individuals? There is a possibility, there is a latent human being that is so strong and so resilient within every human being. Adversity brings it out sometimes. sometimes sheer will and sheer desire to do something brings it out. This brings me to a very interesting quote that I recently read that has been playing in my head by Christopher Reeve. He said, ever so often, so many of our dreams first seem completely impossible. And then they seem improbable. But if you summon your will, they soon become inevitable. Wishing all of you this inevitable strength that I know is going to take you through all your dreams. Open your minds, open your hearts, open your lives to possibilities, and you have a fabulous, beautiful world waiting out there for you to create on your own and to rule it and completely own it. I'm going to leave you again here with this beautiful video clip that shows you what I'm talking about, and that's how it's done. Thank you so much.
I love cycling, and it's so beautiful. Manali to Khardungla was a cycling expedition we started in 2016. This was our fourth batch of people with and without disability. We had blind riders, we had amputee riders, we had single-handed riders, we had able-bodied riders, cancer survivors. In a country like India, these two communities of persons with and without disability live completely isolated lives or separate lives.
तो सब मुझे बहुत पूछते कि अरे पहले तो ऐसे होते कि अरे तू साइकिल चलाता है तू साइकिल कैसे चलाता है एक हाथ से साइकिल के लिए एक हाथ का मीन पैर दो पांव तो है वो भी काफी है मैं तो अभी मिला हूँ बंदे को एक पांव नहीं है वो भी साइकिलिंग कर रहा है
आप ऐसे लोगों को मिलते हो इस जर्नी में आप कभी एक्सपेक्ट नहीं करते कि ऐसे लोग भी इस दुनिया में एग्जिस्ट करते हैं
The purpose why we do tandem cycling is essentially to get people with and without disability to come and play together, to experience the camaraderie, the togetherness, and over time we build friendships. We learn to celebrate our differences. It builds empathy. That's the foundation towards making this world more inclusive.
To make people aware that people with disabilities, whether it's an amputee or a visual disability, also got the same aspirations as them. We also want to do things. We also want to be treated with dignity and respect.
That is it.